Roar Skålin is the next person speaking to us, and he is from the Research Council, Norwegian Research Council, and he will talk a bit about the research funders' policies on access to research data. So welcome, Roar.
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me, and thank you to the Science Library also for taking this initiative. So I'll talk about research funders' policies. Now, of course, the biggest research funder here at the university is the university itself. Their policy will be covered by the next talk. So I'll talk about the policy of the Research Council of Norway, and as well of the Horizon 2020 program of the European Union. So let's jump to it. We do have a policy at the Research Council. It's a policy for open access to research data. It covers the research data that is generated through research partially funded by us. Of course, we cannot say that everyone should follow the policy, but we should say that could say that all the projects partially funded by us should follow this policy. The policy is simple. It's open by default with some exceptions. And those exceptions are the usual ones. It could be security and confidentiality issues, protection of personal data, legal requirements, and also we do fund innovation at the Research Council, and of course then there will be some commercial use, so that could be a reason for not having the data open. And then we have one point which not everyone includes, and then we say that open the data where the cost outperforms the value of open access, well then you don't have to do open access. So you have to do a judgment yourself. What is really the cost of preserving this data compared to the value? We have chosen to take a carrot rather than a stick approach. The reason for that is we did a survey among 7,000 Norwegian scientists, and they were generally positive towards open data, but there are some elements missing to implement it. So we would really like to strengthen the positive attitude that's there, but at the same time we realize the tools are not there yet. So we formulate this policy as guidelines and principles, which are recommendations and best practices, not absolute requirements. See, here are some examples of these guidelines. I'll not read all of them, but mention a few. So the data should be archived at established data centers, not on your own PC, but established data centers. And the examples are NorthStar, which is part of the national e-infrastructure covering large data sets, NSD, which now has the name Norwegian Center for Research Data, which stores data in the area of social sciences, humanities, climate, health, environment. And then you have domain-specific solutions like Elixir for the life sciences. Another one is that we say that you should make the data available as early as possible, but we allow you to have an embargo period so you can publish your results before making the data openly available. We do encourage you to use licenses on the data. That's good for you and it's good for the users. The users know what they can do with the data if you equip them with a license. Without the license, they don't know what rights they have. And you should have a plan for long-term plan for data curation. What do we do to implement this policy? Well, we have a couple of mandatory rules. One which has actually been in our contracts for many, many years, and we say that it's the obligation of the project owners. That's not the scientists. The project owner is the university. It's the obligation of the university to ensure that all these data are stored in a secure digital archive. Then we are working on how to handle data management plans, and in some form we will request data management plans. I'll get a bit back to that. We have, as from last year, said that all the costs relating to archiving and publishing open data may be included in applications for funding. So they are eligible costs. Then we are funding a number of infrastructures that facilitates open access to research data. Up till now, we have funded approximately 30 infrastructures. Some of them are here at the university, and NorStory is one of these. They are mainly in the areas at the geosciences, life sciences, social sciences, and humanities. We want to establish an arena for dialogue and learning between the service providers and the data archives, libraries being one part of this. And then we work on the international arena to establish rewards, incentives, standards, and not least, infrastructures. What is a data management plan, and why should you have one? Well, a data management plan is there to help you, think what is the value of my data, how should I preserve that value, and how should I make sure that others can exploit the value of my data. Data management plans have been part of applications for funding in the US for some time now, and it's gradually coming here in Europe as well. For now, I think in UK, it's you have to have a data management plan with your application. The problem is that not very many scientists know how to write a data management plan. And we have also experienced that not very many reviewers of applications know how to review a data management plan. Luckily, this is things are happening. There is a very good tool for writing data management plans, which has been developed by the Digital Curation Center in the UK. It's called DMP Online. This is the one we recommend, and this is also the one which is recommended by Horizon 2020. And it will be translated and adapted for use here in Norway, so that you will get an easy tool for writing your data management plans. Yeah, and here I mentioned the Horizon 2020. Horizon 2020 has a pilot on open research data. If you participate, if you get a grant from Horizon 2020 and you participate in this pilot, you have to write a data management plan within the first 6 months of the project. And if you do that, you will have to deposit the data in a repository of your choice, but it will have to be a repository that takes care of the data for long term. You will have to take measures to make it possible to access, mine, exploit, reproduce, and disseminate free of charge. So, for instance, using the Creative Commons license, such as we do. And you should provide information about the tools and instrument to exploit the data and validate the results, and if possible, also provide those tools and instruments. The good thing here is that Horizon 2020 will cover the cost. So cost relating to implementation of this pilot is also eligible costs and included in your grant. Now, this pilot is exactly that. It's a pilot. It's not mandatory. You can, for very many reasons, say, yes, I have a project, I will generate data, but I do not want to be part of the pilot. And you can use, well, any of these reasons. And the last one says there are other legitimate reasons not to take part in the pilot. And you can even opt out during your project. However, if you are in there, you will get help. European Commission has also funded a number of projects to help you with taking care of your data and giving access to your data. One of these projects that they have funded is called EU.DAT, the new version of it, EU.DAT 2020. University of Oslo takes part in that project. Now, this is very much in the process of being established, and there are a lot of words that characterize this open data movement. There seem to be some convergence now, and there will be an article coming out soon discussing the FAIR guiding principle for scientific data management. And FAIR means findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. So these are quality marks of open data. That's a concept I think we will hear more about. So this is one thing going on. The other main thing which is very much discussed within the European Union now is something called the European Open Science Cloud. Now, you think that, well, most people associate with a cloud some data somewhere. You don't know exactly where, but you can access them. Well, there has been a high-level expert group trying to figure out what the European Open Science Cloud is, and the leader of that group, he says that, well, it's not European, it's global. It's not a cloud, it's all the tools that you need. It's a virtual environment for all European researchers or globally to store, manage, analysis, and reuse your data. It's not only for science. It could be also for public use of the data and for official use, governmental use of the data. And it doesn't even have to be open, because this cloud or system should be available also to those that have, for instance, data that has to be protected because of privacy reasons. Exactly how this is going to be, we don't know yet, but we are pretty sure that this will be funded partially by the European Union, partially by others. It will come to a PC near you. Exactly now, when it will happen, I don't know. But this is something to watch out for. So I think that's it. Thank you very much.